Ladies and gentlemen, it's Dwale. I'm going to be on the next episode of Kurt TNT, Straight Facts. Holla at me, Dwale underscore CTL. Ladies, you know what to do. Subscribe.
Back at it again, baby. You already know Kurt TNT, Straight Facts. Yeah. We have our man Dwale here with us.
What's up, man? Thanks for y'all. I appreciate y'all.
Appreciate you for being here. Yeah, thank you for having us. So I was going to ask you, what's your main inspiration for creating music?
Honestly, like, it's pretty straightforward to me. I'm not gonna lie, like, women influence my music 100%. So, you know, straight up, you know, the idea, depending on like my current situation, like at the moment with a shorty, but you know, I just get so much inspiration from girls. I don't know what it is, just like that. So, yeah, that's pretty much what my inspiration. But you know, also at the same time, it comes with being myself too. So, you know, me putting the work in. And, doing something that I like doing, so you know what I'm saying.
So, would you say that you're passionate about making music overall?
Yeah, yeah, I'm 100% passionate about it. Just like I said, like the type of music that I make is usually, you know, related to, like, you know, love, yeah, you know, passion, you know, all that. So that's why I say, like, it usually comes from the influence of women, because you know that's pretty much how it sorts it out. You know?
It makes sense. It makes sense. Yeah. How did you first get introduced to music, to making music?
So basically, like back in the days in high school, you know, I think it was like ninth grade. I used to always have a Samsung back in the days. So like I had like the notes, I used to like write little poems and shit. So I could write little poems and shit, and you know, I used to always keep it to myself type of thing. But then, you know, with the courage of like the people that I had around me, like, oh, you should really like do something about it, you know, with the time eventually, you know, kinda build a little more courage, which made me, you know, kinda put it more out there type of thing, you know, instead of keeping it to myself.
Can we say that you've got a lot of support from your friends and family overall making music?
I'll say more friends, not really family. it's not really a subject, you know.
Speak on it.
Especially, you know, my background, you know, it's not really what they expect you to be doing. So, you know, I kind of brush it off because at the end of the day, it's not a topic of conversation that they're not gonna be willing to have, which I gotta respect. Yeah. But at the end of the day, like, you know, our families, they all have all different expectations for us. So, you know, by the end of the day, you gotta live your life. So,
yeah, that's very true, right?
But in terms of the friends, part of things, yeah, 100%. I always make sure I got the right friends around me, you know, no sugarcoating shit. Like, you know, if you don't fuck with my shit, let me know you don't fuck with it. Yeah. You know, I don't need people
sugarcoating with me.
Yeah, honestly, you know, it's all that matters. So, yeah, in terms of my circle of friends, yeah, I really, you know, I got love for them. And, you know, it's 100%.
That makes sense. It's good to have a good group of
friends. Okay, I know that you said, like, women is what influences your music, like, yeah. Was there like a certain female artist or is there a male artist that is like in the same way, like, influenced by women that you like,
so
you got your inspiration to do music for? Or?
So honestly, I'm not gonna lie, I don't know if y'all, like, I'm a really big Party Next Door fan, like, Party Next Door fan.
Party Next Door, okay.
So me, just his vibe, you know, just how, you know, how vulnerable he is being in the mic, like, I really, like, it really speaks to me, you know, so. I'm not saying the toxic part of him, it's me, you know what I'm saying, but just the basic idea of like the type of music he does, that's where I really get my influence from. So he's one of my favorite artists, so yeah.
And also, like, based off of like the music that you make, you said like it's only like your friends that like it. Have you gotten a lot of feedback from females?
So yeah, just the different genders, it doesn't matter, you know what I'm saying, and the type of songs that I make usually, you know, I'm not expecting men, like, my boys to play it in their car, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, most of the time it's going to be shorties playing it, so I got a good group of girls that, you know, that give me feedback. But yeah, you know, at the end of the day, like I said, me, it's all about not sugarcoating it. And, you know,
so far on your music journey, like, from based on the music you have, where has it taken you? Like, what have you enjoyed about this experience?
Honestly, for me in general, in terms of music, it, you know, what I really love about it is the experience of it is just being myself, you know what I'm saying? And I feel like that's what's really important when it comes to doing music, because you can't, like, I'm not the type of guy I'll write something about that I'm not doing, that I have, that I don't have, things that I can't do. That's
so you're honest.
Yeah, I'm honest. Yeah, I'm honest. You can fact check me if you want. I'm honest, you know? But yeah, just about being myself in the music and also, you know, try to connect, you know, to a deeper, like, within me, you know? Mm-hmm. And, one thing that was really hard for me at the beginning was, you know, recording was, you know, I'm not trying to sound dramatic, but it's really about like being vulnerable behind the mic. Mm-hmm. It's really not easy, especially when you got like some of your boys in the studio. You know what I'm saying? But like I said, it all comes with time. Mm-hmm. And you know, I got my feet wet and, you know, now I'm used to it, so no, I can't complain.
And in this music journey you have, what was the best advice that was given to you?
It comes back to the same thing, be myself, like I said. Honestly, I can't fake who I am. I can't try to be like someone else. It's cool to get ideas from other people. That you can never deny that. It's like, it's the same thing with music in general, like the whole like sampling idea, you know, you're always gonna get ideas from other things, previous records, previous artists, etc. But at the end of the day, you gotta have like a foundation for yourself to work on. So yeah, to answer your question, it's really just being myself and, you know, being comfortable with what I'm doing.
That's big facts. Yeah. In your studio, do you keep things around you that keep you like inspired, like around the studio? Because I know, like, you know, you talk about your motivation and stuff.
Yeah.
Right? So
I'm not gonna lie. Like, honestly speaking, like, I like having a little drink in the studio. A little drink in the studio with my shisha too. You know what I'm saying? Sense the vibe. Yeah, you know. You know what I'm saying? So it's kind of hard on the throat sometimes, pause, but you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? But, you know, it sets the mood straight, you know what I'm saying? So, but yeah, no, that's the vibe I like to go on with, you know, a few drinks and, you know, a little hookah going on. It sets the mood straight for me, so.
Where's one place you want to hear your music get played?
Being played, honestly, in the UK, to be honest, like in the UK, London, like my song Ayana is literally like, I don't know if you guys heard of Be Young, y'all heard of Be Young? Yeah, so basically it's the same type of beat, so I feel like.
Is that the one on YouTube?
Yeah, there's one on YouTube, yeah, so it's pretty much the same type of vibe, you know, like, people say I look like him too, I'm not gonna really say that, but, you know what I'm saying, but yeah, so I would say like somewhere in the UK, London area, you know, that I feel like that would really touch me if I hear it from there, so.
Speaking of the song, you know, how is your creative process like?
So, the idea behind Ayana, so basically, yes, it's a female name, so it's based on a girl. You know, basically it was this one night I was in Montreal. One night I was in Montreal, you know how it is, you know, guy, I'm lit, you know, I'm just having a good time. And yeah, I see this one girl, it's the night same outside, you know what I'm saying, so. Yeah, you know, little compa, little zoo, you know what I'm saying?
Got to,
you know, right? You got to, of course. But yeah, you know, little bouillé, you know? but yeah, so I just, that night was just like so, like, I remember like it was yesterday because it was the moment that we had and, you know, what happened afterwards as well. Like, it was, you know, shout out to Ayan, you know? Shout out to Ayan still, you know what I'm saying? Probably don't remember me, but I remember your name. But yeah, shout out to you still, man. Shout out to you, but yeah, so that's pretty much the basic idea of Ayana. Her name is Ayan, but not a lot of things are wrong with Ayan, you know? So yeah. I'm just like, let me do Ayana. So yeah, that's part of the creative process. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? So, but yeah, but shout out to you guys.
What do you have planned for the rest of 2022?
So, when I dropped Ayana, you know, I had a little break, you know, in terms of like personal things, a lot of things happened in life that, you know, can't really control, so I was kind of stopped music for a good like 8 months, but I recently hopped on a track with my boy Nifty. It's called By the Day. You know, it's a summer banger, it's a nice track, it's like Keys on Back type track, it's a banger. But me, for myself personally, I do have 2 singles that's supposed to be coming out in July, hopefully in July. Like I said, me, I'm someone, I know I don't have a lot of songs out, but just because I'm very picky with my music, I don't like dropping it half, thinking, I don't know. Like me, I really gotta feel it, then I really gotta make sure it's correct. And it can go against me sometimes, because especially in the state that I'm in as an artist, you know, you always wanna like push the music. But me, it's like, I can't push it if I'm not feeling it myself.
So, quality content.
You know what I'm saying? So that's what it is. And I'm not degrading like the other people that, you know, that just push music, you know, do your thing. But for me, it's not my thing just to keep pushing it without, you know, having the quality and having.
Quality over quantity.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? So,
QOQ.
Yeah, thanks.
So if the people were to reach you, your information, where could they get you? Where can they find you on?
I'm on everything. I'm on Tidal, Spotify, I'm on Apple Music.
Name a song that you want the people to go listen to right now. They tune in to you. Speak volumes, man.
If you listen to Ayana, I'm telling you, if you listen to Ayana, for me, it's a banger. I worked hard on it, and you know, I feel like the people will leave up with it.
So. And that's what?
So sorry?
That's straight facts.
Straight facts.
Back at it again. You know how we do. My name is Glenn. Okay, today we got a guest on the show. Present, what's your name? What are people in there?
And my name is Duale. You know, Duale CTL. I do music, artist, musician. You know, I'm here today with the boys. I'm invited
Yeah, you're gonna get to know him. He's gonna talk about sport, talk about music, talk about, you know, why he's in this game. He represents Ottawa, and yeah.
Who do you think's the best point guard in the last three eras? Like, you know, you got in the 90s, you got the Stockton.
No, no, don't give the names. Just say, the year, and then just let the people say.
You know, so you know, so just out of the panel, who do you think is the best point guard in the 90s, mm-hmm. the 2000s? Mm-hmm. And in our current, you know, 20, mm-hmm. okay. 10.
Okay. Alonso, what you thinking?
That's a good question. Honestly, my answer, I would say, like, the ones that had heart was definitely in the 90s to the 2000s. Like, preferably, like, I would say Gary Payton. That was one of my favorite point guards, Jason Kidd. You know, if we want to put in the 90s, I guess Magic Johnson kind of counts because he did come back after... you know, retiring from HIV.
Jason Kidd only 3 years old.
Regardless, it's part of the 90s, my friend. Yeah, we gotta be realistic.
You know? What did he do in the first 3 years?
He went to the finals and lost to Jordan in 91. That's a fact. So he was
Jason Kidd lost in 91.
No, we're talking about Magic Johnson. All
right.
Yeah. Steve Nash is in there too.
Would you consider Michael Jordan a point guard? Though?
No.
No, he's a shooting guard.
Shooting guard.
6'6" shooting guard.
Some people
Damon say Stoudemire was there. You know.
Some people say we call him a point guard, though, right? So depending on who you talk to.
But I'm asking who's the best point guard. You just gave me like 20.
I gave you 20?
You gave me the 2 or 3.
Who's the best point guard
best
like
guard
all
in the
90s. Time?
I'm
about
saying in the 90s.
In the 90s for me is Gary Payton, the glove.
All right.
Facts.
And then 2000s?
Steve Nash?
Steve Nash is cool, but he didn't shine until the 2000s.
Steve Nash is Steve Nash.
British Columbia's very own.
Yeah,
British
right.
Team Canada. Yeah, come on now.
Would you give someone else, another name than Steve Nash? Or in 2000?
Team Canada?
In 2000,
is it back-to-back MVP?
And in 2000, who would you give it to?
In 2000?
Yeah.
Steve Nash. Back-to-back MVP.
Right.
So is your answer Steve Nash is the best point guard of all the eras that we're talking about?
In 2000, in 2000.
Hold up. 2000 is the best point guard of Steve Nash.
Nash, yeah. Vancouver. British Columbia. Because I'm with Vancouver. Definitely British Columbia.
So even your boy, Deron Williams, you didn't put him in that category. You forgot about him?
Deron Williams would be my better point guard in 2010s. Is my point
he left guard. Utah. He was done after that, my friend. He was doing damage in 07, 08, 09.
If you're going to give Jason Kidd the 90s, I can give Deron Williams the 2010s.
No, Jason Kidd is different, though. He took New Jersey Nets to the finals twice. We're talking about a Nets that had nobody.
What about LeBron James?
He's a point forward. He's a point forward. Is his handles the best? Because me, I want, if you're a point guard, you got to have handles too. You know, like, LeBron can get stripped.
Steve Nash had great handles.
Yeah, Steve Nash. I'm not saying Steve Nash is not.
What about John Stockton? You think his handle is the best?
Yeah, he was quick.
His handles?
Listen, he did a quick 1-2 and he was gone. You have to catch up to that speed.
And John Stockton?
Yeah. No, he blew by Isaiah. He definitely did. He gave people the business.
What's your opinion on who the best?
What's your opinion?
Me, honestly, like, depending on the era, right? Because I'm talking about like 90s.
Well, what you saw?
Honestly speaking, if we're speaking about Stockton, like, you can't neglect, like, you know, all-time steals, you know, you can't neglect that part of the floor, you know. So I know you said Gary Payton, you know, that's a good one as well.
Right.
One defensive player of the year and all that. But honestly, for me speaking, like, me, I'm an AI guy, Allen Iverson.
Right.
You know, at the end of the day, he didn't win no championship. But
how many MVPs did he win?
MVP, no
one,
no.
One?
Yeah.
Okay, so AI, was he more of a scoring? Because I feel like if he was a point guard, he got to get, like, triple-doubles, at least 8 assists.
Or back-to-back MVPs.
That's just one criteria.
You know, one of those years that was Kobe. That was Kobe.
Okay, what else? I'm
just saying.
What about in any era, if you had two point guard to the backcourt to start to, who would you be? What about you, Lonzo?
Okay, from the 90s?
It doesn't have to be. It doesn't matter. 90s, 2000, like whichever.
1-2? Okay.
1-2. Just give me a 1-2. Backcourt.
I would take Gary Payton.
Yeah.
And then I would take Russell Westbrook.
What?
Yeah,
come on,
because you need a Gary Payton.
What?
Let me explain why. Because Gary Payton would be telling Russell Westbrook how to be a man. He wouldn't do none of that soft shit.
He's from Oakland.
That's what it is. No, I'm telling you, you need the right person. No, we're talking basketball.
You're not being serious, Russell Westbrook.
Yeah, Russell Westbrook. I believe in him. Y'all just had a bad year. It happens, man. It's nothing. What would you take?
I wouldn't take Russell Westbrook, that's a fact. That's a straight
okay,
fact.
Okay, that's nice, but what's your answer though?
I would probably take
Ben Simmons, what's going on?
We'll probably take Steve Nash.
Okay.
Great choice.
And I will probably take.
You know, you're getting abused on defense with Steve Nash, but it's okay. That's another thing.
He can't play.
Steve Nash got steals. He can't play a lick of. Yo, he gets steals off of a system. He never actually scored.
I'll probably take Isaiah Thomas. Thank you. Isaiah Thomas was good, but Steve Nash is a defensive stopper.
You know, on that note, you know what I mean?
I will take Isaiah Thomas and Steve Nash.
I can't allow Steve Nash slander, but you know, we can definitely say that Steve Nash backed up MVP and one of Canada's best point guards.
Right.
And up next, you got Jamal Murray. He's about to take that crown sooner than later, you know? So don't sleep. The return of Jamal Murray, and that's straight facts. Straight facts.
Back at it again. You know what it is.
Yo, what do you guys think is going to win the NBA Finals this year?
Yeah, I want to hear what the Alonzo has to say.
I said if you look at the chats and a few groups that we have, I said Warriors will win it. I'm still sticking to that opinion because at the end of the day, like I said, when Klay Thompson comes back, it's a problem for the West. So I told people like the Lakers and the Clippers to get their act together because now the Golden State boys are back. So and they're the most tested team. If you look at the teams that they've beaten before in the past, they beat LeBron's teams, they beat Kevin Durant teams, they beat James Harden's team. So not to say Boston's not a good team, I just feel that it's not their time. But they definitely have a good team. I got to respect their coaching and the players for stepping up when it matters. You know?
How does it look in the wallet?
6-7, I think.
Honestly speaking, like, I feel like it's going to be Celtics in 6, to be honest. Okay. I feel like, you know, Warriors, like, you can never go against them. You know, they got that championship DNA in them.
Mm-hmm.
But, I feel like in order for them to really win, I feel like Klay's got to be Klay. Like, the Klay we know we're talking about.
Game 6 play.
And we got to make sure Jordan Poole as well is doing what he's doing right now.
Right.
I feel like if one of those little things go up, I feel like it can go south for them. So,
what about Kevon Looney?
Kevon Looney's nice. You know,
what about Andrew Wiggins?
Andrew Wiggins, for sure. Forget about Vaughn, Andrew Wiggins, Kansas' very own Andrew Wiggins. What?
Tell him.
Not even just that,
even coaching wise, I think they have a man. I just think that they have a better coach.
But they both come from the Popovich system.
I hear you, but in the end of the day, that's been 6 out of 8 years that they've been in the finals,
mm-hmm.
and the Warriors know what they're doing, right? And they're comfortable in what they're doing, and I think they know who's doing what, right?
Yeah, but Zoe's favorite player, LeBron, is in the finals the last 10 years, and look at what his record was. Was it 4-6? 4 out of 5 or 6? You know what I mean? 4 wins, 6 losses?
Yeah, we're not talking about LeBron right now. We're talking about the Warriors, and the Warriors are doing things differently.
So my question for you is, do you think it's going to be a blowout or is it going to be games?
Come on, Boston, you know, Boston beat, what's it called? Brooklyn?
Mm-hmm.
They beat.
That's not a good team. Okay.
What I'm saying, it's not a good team. It's not a good team, but they still beat Kevin Durant and Kyrie.
Two players from the 75th.
Right?
One player from the 75th.
Okay, and they beat those guys there. They beat Miami, right?
They beat Milwaukee, right?
But without who? Chris Middleton.
But they still beat them. They still did what they had to do.
Cakewalks.
All right? They still. And the end of the day is, Boston's a harder matchup for the Warriors than Miami. That's a strong
Miami making it that far, you and I both know one, never happened. Because Lonzo's favorite player, Kyle Lowry, like, you know what I mean? Like, Lonzo's favorite player, Kyle Lowry, like, he really believed that he was going to bring them to the finals.
In the end of the day, like, I think Steph Curry's going to do his thing. I think Steph Curry's defense is not as bad as what people might think. And that Kuminga, he's out there.
My question to you is this. The fact that the Warriors just watched them move to a 7-game series, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they played yesterday, right? The Warriors have been rested since when? Friday of last week. And the game starts this Thursday.
Okay.
Who has the advantage right now?
But it has not, resting at this point doesn't matter. When it comes to finals, it's all about who wants it the most. How you can be rested 4 days, 5 days. I don't think it makes a big difference.
Okay.
And what to me, the thing that makes a big difference is the two teams, the two best defenses in the league.
Okay.
Boston is then one of the best defense in the league, and the Warriors is one of the best defense in the league.
Okay.
What the main thing that's the most crucial is the turnover game. So whoever that does the less turnovers would, I think, would win the basketball game. So
do you think Boston can compete with the 3-point shooting of the Warriors? Because I see that Boston,
I think
they shoot a lot against Miami.
But what's called Steph Curry's scored 18 threes in the whole playoff.
Mm-hmm.
What's his name? Jason Tatum scored 18 threes himself,
mm-hmm.
and then Jalen Brown scored 19 threes himself. Mm-hmm. So they do have them shooters, even though how you might think that. That the Warriors score more threes. Boston score a lot of threes as well. That's why I said to you guys, whoever does less turnovers would win the series.
So it's just turnovers. It's not just like there's an actual offensive edge.
Turnovers, and the other thing would be rebounding as well.
Okay.
Because Steph Curry like to rebound the ball and push the ball up and do what they do with the whole Draymond Green thing and how to set up their.
So what are your X factors in the matchup? Like for
Andrew Wiggins.
Wiggins, come on.
Wiggins for you.
Vaughn, Ontario Wiggins.
So my X factor is Jordan Poole.
Rookie of the year Wiggins.
Andrew Wiggins. And what's his name?
Boston?
Draymond Green.
No, but you. And that's what about for Boston?
I'm telling you, Warriors.
They're like three X factors. I just need one. Just one series.
So like Draymond Green.
Okay.
Wiggins, obviously.
That's two.
Jordan Poole for the Warriors.
Okay. One from each team. Just one from each team. Like that is gonna make.
Even those guys,
that's like three players.
The guys are coming back. Like Otto Porto's coming back. What's his name? Gary Payton's name is coming back. Junior.
KVP. Can you just give me one X factor from each team?
For Boston, I would say
just one, not four players, just one X factor. That's
what I say. I would say Boston, Trent Williams.
Greg Williams or Grant Williams?
Greg Williams, yeah.
My goodness. Okay, and
Russell Webber, let's be honest.
I think the X factor for Boston is Jalen Brown.
I say Grant Williams.
I don't believe in Grant Williams.
Check this out. I said Grant Williams and Marcus Smart. Because Marcus Smart
makes more sense.
Because Marcus Smart gave the less field goal percentage.
He's going to have to do a dream on those for the Warriors.
What he does to Steph Curry. You know what I'm saying? So, anyways, that's what my take is. But,
yeah.
If you have a better take than that.
Listen, I said for Boston it's Jalen Brown, and I think for the Warriors it's Klay Thompson, 100%. Because at the end of the day, we know what the others can do. We just haven't seen Klay play in a while. But I'm not afraid about Golden State. I think it's a dynasty that's been waiting to happen. So they're gonna get their fourth ring for Steph Curry, and I think it's their seventh title for the whole organization. So that's good.
And even if the day is not good for Kevin Durant, but on that note, it's facts.